Thank you. dying, Christ destroyed our death. In rising, Christ restored our life. And Christ will come again in glory. As in baptism, Linwood put on Christ. So in Christ, may Linwood be clothed with glory. Here and now, dear friends, we are God's children. What we shall be has not yet been revealed. But we know that when He appears, we shall be like Him. For we shall see Him as He is. Those who have this hope purify themselves as Christ is pure.
Said, I am the resurrection, and I am life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. And I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also. Friends, we have gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Ezra Linwood Denning. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, and in sorrow hope, and in death resurrection. If you'll follow along with me in the bulletin now in the order of service and say the prayer in the bowl with me. May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray together. Eternal God, we praise you for the great company of all those who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labor. We praise you for those dear to us whom we name in our hearts before you. Especially we praise you for Linwood, whom you have graciously received into your presence. To all of these, grant your peace. Let perpetual light shine upon them, and help us so to believe where we have not seen, that your presence may lead us through our years and bring us at last with them into the joy of your home, not made with hands, but eternal in the heavens, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Lord is, I live in my own.
Words from Psalm 130. Out of the depths I cry unto thee, O Lord. Lord, hear my cry. Let thine ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication. If thou, Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with thee, that thou may be feared. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his words do I hope. My soul waits for the Lord, more than those who watch for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is great mercy, with him is plenteous redemption, and he will redeem Israel from all their sins. Now hear these words from the Old Testament, from the book of Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 through 8 and 28 through 31. Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all of her sins. A voice cries out, in the wilderness prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all the people shall see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? All people are grass. Their constancy is like a flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, when the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers and the flower fades. But the word of our God will stand forever. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is an everlasting God, the creator of the ends and of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with the wings like eagles, and they shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. If you'll join me once again in your bulletins for him, the reading of the 23rd Psalm, please read along with me. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord. Now hear these words from the New Testament lesson from Romans chapter 8, various verses. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. If the Spirit of him who's raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also, through his Spirit that dwells in you. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God, and if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? And as it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are counted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor heights, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And then hear these words from the Gospel of John, chapter 14, various verses. Jesus said, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again, and I will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I'm going. I will not leave you orphaned, and I am coming to you. In a little while the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. I have said these things to you while I am still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. And do not let them be afraid." Friends, this is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing to you. Lord, you're our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Ezra Linwood Denning, born in December of 1950, go home to be with his Lord in September of 2022. Father to Jeffrey, father-in-law to Melissa, grandfather to Joshua, Jacob, Megan, and Mitchell, great-grandfather to Titi or Bentley, and Bubba or Vince, whichever y'all know him by. A special friend to Doreen Kern and Jarvis Tark and to Polly Bird. Jarvis told me a little bit about him and Linwood's friendship. And he said a lot of stories he couldn't share with me, which y'all may have some of those yourself. But he did share with me that one time him and Linwood decided to go to Myrtle Beach, or go to Carolina Beach without any reservations. And I guess Jarvis, you was a cool dude. You had a Corvette. The top was down, I assume. And they go ride down and drive around all night at Carolina Beach, him and Linwood, looking for a place to stay. Was no place to stay. So they ride to Myrtle Beach. Ride around all night in Myrtle Beach. Couldn't find a place to stay. So I can imagine Linwood was ill. Jarvis might have been ill at this point. So they go back to Carolina Beach. Nothing changed. Nobody checked out early. Still no places to stay. So Jarvis said that his last memory, they go to the beach and stay in Wilmington. And they finally found a hotel there in Wilmington to stay. But Jarvis told me Linwood was a good friend. And he was always there for him. He said he wanted to strangle Linwood a few times. And I'm sure Linwood wanted to strangle Jarvis a few times. And then I talked to his good buddy, Durain, this morning, Durain Curran. Durain said he couldn't say a whole lot either, that he could share. But he did say that one time he thought he was going to strangle Linwood. They were fishing for sheephead down at the beach under the bridge, and Durain was sitting in the seat up front. It spins around pretty quick, and Linwood turned the boat real fast, and Durain thought he was going to fly off the boat. He said all Linwood could do was laugh at him. And after he got over it for a minute, Durain said he laughed too. But thank you guys for being his good friend and for being there for him. And Polly, who's been there these last year or so to help take care of Linwood, you were a good friend to him. Actually, I have not seen Linwood. Never really talked to Linwood. When I first moved to Coates almost five and a half years ago, Linwood was in the hospital in a coma. And I went to see him once a week or so. And I'd go in and I would pray for him and talk to him a little bit and just sit with him. And he never said anything. And then later on, he was sent to Lillington, I think, to a rehab place over in Lillington. So I finally got to talk to him a few times. And then he got out and I would see Linwood at Moss Grill or up at the grocery store. But I didn't get to know Linwood the way all of you know him. But he sounds like an interesting guy. He was an electrician for Burlington Industries and later Kelly Springfield. When I went over to visit with Jeffrey and to visit with Linwood a couple weeks ago, when I had a good conversation with Linwood, I noticed how beautiful his yard is. And they said he loved to mow and he loved his flowers and his, I guess, roses were out there. And just how immaculate it was. It was really a beautiful yard. And they said he loved taking care of his yard and he was proud of that. And he was very proud of his roses. The family said that he loved to cook. Melissa even said that Linwood would modify his cooking to her taste. He wouldn't do that for anybody else. And then Jeffrey was telling me about there's a family tradition that started with Linwood's father that Jeffrey still carries on, and I assume your sons will, of making hot chow chow, mild and hot chow chow. I got a jar of each and I hadn't tried them yet, but I'm going to try that soon, especially the hot. And I think there was a thing of it in Linwood's coffee last night of chow chow. I assume the hot kind. But he said he loved to cook, and they said Durain had an outdoor kitchen. Or a kitchen outside or something. So Linwood had to have one. And he was proud of that and he loved cook. But maybe he just loved to be with you guys that would come over and cook with him or eat with him or share a meal at his table. Jarvis was telling me that Linwood loved to water ski. Y'all didn't tell me that. He said him and Jarvis liked to water ski. And he had a love of fishing, especially fishing for sheephead. So he must have been a good fisherman. I saw the fishing pole last night, and is that the one with the fish on it? And sheephead are hard to catch. It's a guy in our church, Lewis Peterson, that he loves to go fishing for sheephead. But they said Linwood was an avid fisherman, and if you watched the video last night, if you came up, or if you go online to view the obituary, you can see a lot of pictures of Linwood fishing and how he loved to fish. And then Linwood loved riding his motorcycle. Loved to get out. And I probably think he felt a bit of freedom when he was on his motorcycle, as most motorcycle riders do. But I asked the family, mainly Jeffrey and Melissa and Polly, and I talked to Durain and Jarvis, and I asked him, give me one or two words to describe Linwood. I'm glad they were honest with me. I'm not a pastor that's going to get up here and sugarcoat and say Linwood was the perfect, most loving human being of all time. Maybe he was. But this is what the family said. Said he was independent. Is that true? Nod your heads. He loved family and friends. Somebody said he was loving. Somebody said he was a pain in the rear, but sweet. Is that true?
Amen.
Somebody said he was full of life and was outgoing. Jarvis and Doreen both told me he was their best friend. They also said he was helpful and would do whatever he could for his friends and family. Somebody said he could be hateful. Is that true? Jeffrey said, and I had to modify the word a little bit, but he said he was an honorary son of a gun. Is that true?
Amen.
Durang told me he used the word honorary too. So now I want to ask the congregation, and for those of you, most of you I don't know, what is one or two words that describes Lynn Wood to you? Yes, ma'am. Your sister.
I'm his sister.
Uh-huh.
And he and I fought from the day he was born. I'm the oldest. But he and I never ended an argument or anything to do with disagreement, which was always, without saying, I'm sorry and I love you.
Right.
And if I left first after the argument, he would find me wherever I was and say, I'm sorry.
Good.
He was always that way with me.
Good memory. Thank you. Anybody else? One or two words that describe Lynn Wood to you?
Funny.
Funny. Funny. Anyone else?
Hey. You didn't wonder where you stood with Lynn, because he was affluent with it and honest. He didn't sugarcoat nothing. But you knew he was your friend when he said it.
So you knew where you stood?
He was something.
Thank you, Durant.
He told it just like it was.
Told it like it was. Yes, sir.
I'm a neighbor.
You're a neighbor?
Yeah. He was a good neighbor.
A good neighbor.
I was one day pouring some cement. I don't know how he even seen me. I was a backyard, we in the backyard. And I was about to give out. I really loved him. And Lynn would come over and said, you sit down under that tree right there. And he went ahead and finished the rest of that concrete that I got.
Huh. So good neighbor.
Good neighbor.
Anybody else?
He spent 6 months over at the house helping me build a new deck behind the house. He'd come over twice a week. We spent all day long working on that deck until we ended up getting it built 100%. So he was anything I needed, but he'd be there.
Taught you a lot of lessons.
Taught me a lot of electrical lessons.
Good. Yes. Anybody else? Mitchell told me last night that he loved to play with his grandpa, and that they liked to tickle each other and play games. And Mitchell, I think you were the light of his life these last few years. And you probably kept him going. And you hold on to those good things, Mitchell, that you and all the rest of the grandkids hold on to those things that your grandpa's taught you. And if he's ever made any of you guys mad or been ornery to you or hateful, as his sister said, know that Lynn Wood was sorry. Lynn Wood made his peace with Christ. I went over to visit Thursday a week ago when he had just got home from the hospital, and Lynn Wood and I sat there and Jarvis and Polly and had a good conversation. And I asked Lynn Wood where he was in his walk with Christ and did he know who Jesus Christ was? And he said, I know Jesus has died for my sins. And he said he knew that Jesus was going to ultimately heal him from all of his pain. And Jesus did that last Thursday morning. I went by Wednesday a week ago. This was Thursday 2 weeks ago, but then I went by Wednesday before he passed away. Polly was there and the little dog, and the dog bit me. That's okay. And I went to see Lynn Wood, and Lynn Wood was asleep on the, he had the morphine patch on, and he knew things were going downhill. And I said a prayer over Lynn Wood, but he was rested.
I think he was just building up his strength to go on to be with the Lord on Thursday morning when he called him home. I was told by Polly from conversations she's had that Linwood was so sorry if he ever hurt anyone in this room or anyone in his life. Later in life, Linwood realized how much his family and his friends meant to him. Mitchell, you were a big part of that. And you were a big part of the change of Linwood. And he loves spending time with you. But Linwood's life wasn't perfect. How many people raise your hand if you've ever not sinned or not made anybody mad or not done anything against the Lord? If you haven't, raise your hand because I want to talk to you later on. I didn't think anybody was going to raise their hand. When I first met Jeffrey Saturday a week ago to talk about Linwood, because I didn't know him very well, it's the first time I've met Jeffrey, we talked about the motorcycle accident. And Linwood went in depth with me on the Thursday 2 weeks ago about his accident and what happened and how it happened and all that. And the first thing Jeffrey did when I started talking to him was start crying. He said that motorcycle accident might have been the best thing that ever happened to Linwood in his relationship and his relationship with his family and friends. Sometimes bad accidents or terrible things can make a big change in a person. And I think it changed Linwood for the better. Was he the man that could go fishing and do all the things that he wanted to do like he used to do and to do things his way or I did it my way? Probably not, but he would try. He would help a neighbor, as we've heard. He would apologize to a sister, and that's hard to do, apologize to a sibling, much less anybody else. But he tried to do it his way. And I think Linwood thought deep in his heart, especially towards the end of his life, he was doing things the right way. And I was thinking about in Linwood and Scripture and the Bible, what would best describe Linwood in a change of his heart and in a change of somebody that was sometimes bitter or somebody that could be hard to get along with, somebody that didn't always understand what God was wanting them to do. And I thought about the story of Jonah and the well. And I think it's a fitting story because Linwood was a fisherman. But if you don't know the story, I would ask you to go into your Bible in the Old Testament sometime and sit down. It's just four short chapters, but it's a great book. Jonah's a man, and God had called him. He said, I want you to go to this town called Nineveh. And I want you to tell them that I am going to destroy them in 40 days if they don't repent and turn to me. Because Nineveh was 120,000 people or person city. And God's gone to him and says, you tell them, walk through there. If they don't fast and pray and return to me, I'm going to destroy them. Noah hated the people in Nineveh. Didn't want to have anything to do with them. He hated the people in Nineveh, didn't want to do it. Tried to go a separate way, and God kept talking to him, said, you need to go to Nineveh, Jonah. So Jonah decides to do his way. And he goes and gets on a boat. He pays money to get on a boat, and he's going to sail away to get away from Nineveh. Well, the sea started raging, and the storm started raging. And then all of a sudden, the sailors on the ship, they said, what's going on? They were praying to their God, praying to any God that they could think of praying to. And Jonah comes up to him and he said, it's my fault, fellas. He said, I've disobeyed God. He said, you need to do whatever God tells you to do. So they picked up Jonah and threw him over the side of the boat. And then the Bible says that the sea subsided. Didn't stop immediately, because storms don't stop immediately. The storms are still going on in Florida, and we pray for our people down there today. But storms, they kind of subside, and they get easier when they threw Jonah over the side of the boat. And Jonah was over on the side of the boat, and all of a sudden, most people say a whale, but a big fish came and swallowed Jonah up. I wonder how Lynn would have liked that if he was fishing, Mitchell. And he fell in the water with the rain, and a a fish swallowed him. So he's inside this fish. Jonah is. And he's praying for God. And there's a beautiful psalm in chapter 3. And a song in chapter 3 that he's praying. And Lord, what have I done? You know, you can imagine the prayers that would be going on. So finally the fish or the whale swims close to Nineveh and spits Jonah out. And he lands on the seashore. He still didn't want to do it, but he went ahead and he said, God's going to destroy these people. I don't like the Ninevites. He said, so I'm going to walk through. And he tells them all about it. Well, lo and behold, the people of Nineveh had a change of heart. The king said he wanted the whole city to fast and pray. And they turned back to God. And God didn't destroy them. And poor Jonah, in his selfish ways, he said, God, I did what I was supposed to. You didn't uphold your bargain. And he goes there, and all of a sudden he's sitting out on a hill watching Nineveh because he wanted a front row seat of God destroying it. It didn't happen, but it was hot and the sun was shining. Kind of like a hot summer day here in Coates. And all of a sudden a bush grew, and he got some shade. And he goes to sleep, and he wakes up, and the bushes died all in one day. So then Jonah gets mad again at God. And God asked him a question. He said, can you make a bush grow in the night? Or can you make it die in the night? He said, it's not up to you what happens to good people, to these people in Nineveh. It's up to me. And he kind of leaves them with the question, and I'm just paraphrasing, what are you going to do with your life? And I think this motorcycle accident was a call to Linwood. What are you going to do with the rest of your life with the time you have left? That's been 5.5 years. My prayer is that it was a good 5.5 years for Linwood. Was all of it easy, Jeffrey?
It wasn't all easy.
Wasn't all easy, was it? Because that storm had to subside. But Jeffrey told me he saw a change in his day. It's evidenced by Mitchell and how much he loved you and how much you love him. Linwood Diddings, a good man. Was he a perfect man? No. But there's only been one of those, and that's Jesus Christ. But what made Linwood close to perfect is he accepted his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He accepted the fact that Jesus died on the cross for him, even though he had a long list of sins, just like we all do. So my question for you is, are you going to wait for a whale to swallow you, or are you going to wait for a motorcycle accident or a car accident or something bad to happen to you to turn your life around? Linwood, I think, turned his life around. And I have no doubt today that he's walking the streets of gold, telling people about his grandsons and granddaughter, telling people about Jeffrey and the man he's become. Telling people about the whole Denning family. And there's a bunch of you here in Coates. When you walk out of here today, know that Linwood loved you. But know that Jesus Christ loves you more. And to TT and Bubba over there, y'all share the good stories with them. Don't let the good part of Linwood die. Carry that on. I love hearing stories even to this day about my grandfather and my great-grandfathers and the things they did for people. So family, that's your charge, is to share the good news of Linwood. Don't let that good news die. And Mitchell and the rest of the family, Jeffrey, you're going to see him again one day if you've accepted Christ like he did. You will see him again walking the streets of gold. And he'll probably have some bigger fishing tales to tell. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you. Let us pray. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you still are God. We pray to you for one another in our need, and for all anywhere who mourn with us this day. To those who doubt, give light. To those who are weak, strength. To all who have sinned, mercy. And to all who sorrow, your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. In all our ways we trust you. And to you, with your church on earth and in heaven, we offer honor and glory now and forever. Amen. O God, all that you have given us is yours. As first you gave Linwood to us, now we give Linwood back to you. Receive Linwood into the arms of your mercy. Raise Linwood up with all of your people. Receive us also and raise us with a new life. Help us so to love and serve you in this world, that we may enter into your joy in the world to come. Amen. Let us pray. God of love, we thank you for all with which mercy you have blessed us even to this day. For the gift of joy in days of health and strength, and for the gifts of your abiding presence and promise in the days of pain and grief. We praise you for home and friends, and for our baptism and place in your church, with all who have faithfully lived and died. Above all else, we thank you, Jesus, who knew our griefs, who died our death and rose for our sake, and who lives and prays for us today. Amen. Strengthened with might through God's Spirit in your inner being, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Amen.